Welcome to Rock of Faith. You're about to watch the service of October 14th when St. Amy of Pastor Jess Tuthill. You can submit prayer requests, offerings, and find everything at our website, roffont.com. The link is in the video description below.
Praise the Lord. Good evening, everyone. It's good to see each one here tonight. We say God bless you. If you're glad to be here, say amen. Well, tonight I have a testimony. I went to my doctor yesterday for a checkup, and they took my blood pressure, and my blood pressure is 141 over 80, and that is the best it's been for years and years and years. So apparently, the issue of having too much salt was the real deal, because it's the only thing I changed. And just within the last time I went there, it's about less than 3 months, my blood pressure came down eons. So we thank the Lord for that. So I praise the Lord for that. He just looked at my chart when he saw that. He knew that, you know, I've been making adjustments. So we praise the Lord for that. Amen. All right, we want to pray for those traveling tonight and all those with jobs. Remember Ray and Teresa and Tom and Cheryl and James and Sam. Linda is traveling this weekend, so let's remember her. She travels to Phoenix. Sam has moved to Phoenix with his family, so let's remember them tonight as well. Praise the Lord. Anyway, we're glad you're here. Would you stand with me? We're going to take these requests, Lord, in prayer. And as our custom is, would you turn to your neighbor and tell him, I love you and you can't do nothing about it. Tell him, I love you and you can't do nothing about it. Amen. And if you would, please repeat after me and say, this is the best day and the best year that I've ever had because Jesus is with me. One more time. This is the best day and the best year that I've ever had because Jesus is with me. Let's give him a clap offering tonight. Amen. Praise the Lord. Let's join together tonight. Let's pray over our service and let's allow God's Holy Spirit to bless us as we worship him tonight. Amen. Father, we thank you tonight in the mighty name of Jesus. We thank you for your goodness and your mercy upon us tonight and the very opportunity to be able to pray. Lord, we lift up these that are sick in body. We remember Tony tonight. God, we ask you to touch him in his body. In the name of Jesus, we remember Gail Lamar tonight. Lord, we ask you to touch her as well. Lord, she needs a touch in her body. Remember Sherry Mosley. God, we're asking you to touch by your mighty power. And for Jenna and Sharon tonight, God, we lift them up in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. For Agnes tonight, God, we ask you to touch that hip. Let it continue to heal. Lord, we lift up every one of these urgent needs, these family members that need help. Father God, we ask you to touch these families. Lord, every conflict, every difficulty, God, that you move by your Spirit. Lord, for every urgent need, Lord, we pray. We give you the glory and the praise and the honor. Lord, we ask you to stir up the gifts of the Spirit and the power of God in our service tonight. Lord, we've come once again to worship you and to give you all the glory and the praise and the honor. Bless our efforts on tonight, Lord. Bless the music. Bless the spoken word. Lord, bless our efforts, Lord, and we'll give you all the glory and the praise and the honor. Lord, we ask these things tonight in your name, the name of Jesus, and everyone said, amen. Let's give him a clap offering tonight, if you would. Praise the Lord. Tonight, we're going to talk about the name of Jesus. The name of Jesus. I'm going to try to share as much as I can. There's quite a few things to say about it, but we're going to share as much as we can. I'm going to ask our sister Mary Lee, would you ask the blessing on the word tonight, please? Praise the Lord. We're going to start with this little quotation. There was a preacher ministering on the name of Jesus. And I'm going to just quote what is being said. One afternoon, while giving an address on the name of Jesus, a lawyer interrupted me, asking, "Do you mean to say that Jesus gave us the power of attorney, the legal right to use his name?" And I said to him, "Brother, you are a lawyer and I am a layman. Tell me, did Jesus give us the power of attorney?" He said, "If language means anything, then Jesus gave the church the power of attorney." Then I asked him, "What is the value of this power of attorney?" He answered, "It depends upon how much there is back of it, how much authority, how much power the name represents." Amen. Then I began to search to find out how much power and authority Jesus had. Tonight we're going to start right here. And the Bible says that we have the right to use the name of Jesus. We have the right to use the name of Jesus in prayer. We have the right to use the name of Jesus when it comes to fighting spiritual battles with demons. We have the right to use the name of Jesus when it comes to sickness and we need healing. And we have the right to use the name of Jesus in any other spiritual battle that we may have or what we may face. I want to make it clear tonight that we are not fighting against flesh and blood. We're not fighting against people. I've heard so many things, and now the election is getting near, that people really think that they're fighting against people if people vote for a certain person. And I want to say tonight, right now, make it very clear, it's not the person that we have the problem with, it's the spirit behind it. Can I get this one amen? Hello. That when someone makes a bad decision, when someone agrees to something that's contrary to the Word of God, no matter who it is, then they're going to reap the results of a bad decision. And tonight, I have, over the years, had to counsel and talk to many people that have made bad decisions. They have the right to use the name of Jesus. They have the right to do things according to the Word of God. But yet they made decisions contrary to the word. And so we don't like to face up to things, but in reality, when we do something wrong or make a bad decision, there are consequences we face. Anybody ever make a bad decision? Hello? Anybody drive too fast on the freeway or some roadway and you got a ticket? Anybody do some other things, make other decisions that weren't prosperous or good? I've made decisions, amen, and sometimes I have made decisions and I haven't prayed, and I've met many people that they have made decisions without praying about it, and so they reap the results of it. There is no way that you can't reap the results of your decisions. Either you make a good decision or you make a bad one. But in the things that we face, people make statements and we base what we believe on their statement that the person made. But in reality, behind the scenes in a spiritual realm, there are things going on that are fighting against the church. There are things that people make decisions on that are contrary to the Word of God. And if those decisions are carried out and sown into the earth, wherever they might be, there's going to be negative consequences to their decisions. Amen. Many people don't realize it. I know people that have made bad decisions. I have seen families destroyed. I have seen other people they lose jobs. I've seen people in various situations where they made a bad decision and they had to reap the result of it. Tonight I'm thinking about a certain situation. I'm not dealing with the people, but this man made a bad decision. And his family's involved, and he's going through terrible, terrible things because of a decision that he made. There isn't anything that we can do tonight that doesn't affect somebody else. Can I get a witness? Amen. You can't make a decision that, I don't care if you only know one other person, it's going to affect them. Can I get a witness? Amen. So we have to make good decisions, and tonight, we're talking about the right to use the name of Jesus. We're talking about we can use the name of Jesus, and his presence and his blessing will help us. Amen. And it said here, as I was reading to you, about what is behind the name of Jesus. What authority does he have? And so we know that on the cross that Jesus defeated principalities and powers. And so by that authority alone, we know that because of what he did, it allows us to fight against spirits that are not godly because Jesus already defeated them. Thank God I don't have to defeat those spirits. Amen. Jesus defeated them for me. And by using the name of Jesus, I can stand against them and receive the blessing that Jesus bought and paid for me to have. Are you with me tonight? Amen. What we have the right because of the power that Jesus invested, amen, on the cross and in the resurrection. Can I get a witness? Amen. Jesus made a statement regarding his name. He said, "Hitherto you've asked nothing in my name. Ask and you shall receive, that your joy may be full." In that representation, that scripture there means you must pray also in line with the word of God. You cannot just pray anything and get it. I know lots of people that teach that and try to do it. If you could do that, you would be driving a gold Cadillac. You would own $100 billion. Can I get a witness? Amen. You wouldn't have any problems at all if you could do that. You can't do that. But you can pray in line with God's word. And according to Philippians, God will supply all of your need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Can I get a witness? Amen. So he can take care of us. It doesn't mean, though, that he'll do it the way we want him to, but he will take care of us. Amen. As we seek the things of God, we must seek them in line with what God has for us. I deal with people, pastors, all the time that want their church to be a certain way. And in the Bible, we're supposed to be building the kingdom of God. It doesn't matter how many people we have, we're supposed to be teaching them the principles. Hello? And I know some people, amen, however many people they have, it's not enough. And so they have a different plan other than God's word to get people into the building. And so they compromise. And they promise people the moon and they can't deliver. Hello? They promise them God's going to do these things for them. And he never said it in his word. And so the church begins to fill up, but it's based on compromise. And God is trying to teach his church the right way to build character into his church and to use the principles of God the way that he instilled them. Again, here we have the right to use his name, but we don't have the right to abuse it. Amen? We have the right to ask him for things that pertain to the covenant promises, but we do not have the right to just ask for the moon. Can I get a witness? Amen. Hallelujah. Y'all, awful quiet tonight. Amen. As I studied about the name of Jesus and I meditate upon it, I realized that God wants me to be able to reap the benefits of his name. A power of attorney, if you have the power of attorney for someone, I've seen many people over the years that when someone gets ill, they give the power of attorney to one of their relatives or friends. And that relative or friend can go and make decisions for their medical condition. They can go to the bank and get money out or put money in. They can do many things because they have the power of attorney. Amen? And so we have the right now, because Jesus died and gone to heaven, that he allows us to use his name without abusing it, but use it to help and assist others in their dilemmas. Amen. I've often ran into people, again, that fight against other people. I don't know if you know or not, but there's more than 20,000 different Christian organizations in America. Many of the Christian organizations, there's hardly any difference in their tenets of faith. Almost all of them are very similar in nature. But one group believes one thing a little bit different than somebody else, and so they start a whole new denomination of people. They boast how they believe one thing different than someone else. They got a different name over the door of the church. I wish I could get a witness. Amen. And because they know one thing more different than someone else, somehow they become better. But that has not helped the body of Christ. Amen. The body of Christ is just one. There's only one Lord, one Savior, one baptism, one Holy Spirit, one Father, one Son, one Spirit. Can I get a witness? Amen. And so therefore, because of that, we should be building the church, not trying to be one up on somebody else. Hello. The right for Jesus, amen, and in the early church, they used the name of Jesus, amen, properly. When Peter and John went to the temple, amen, right after the resurrection, there was a lame man at the gate of the temple, and Peter looked upon him, and he could see that he had faith to be healed. And so he reached down and he said, "Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have give I thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, once again, rise up and walk." And the lame man received strength in his ankles and he was healed. And the Bible says he went walking and leaping and praising God into the temple. So they used the name of Jesus. And when the disciples were questioned about it, they thought that it was their power. And Peter answered and responded, "It's not by our name or our power, our ability, that this man is made whole or well, but by the name of Jesus," amen, "and faith in his name, has this man been made whole." And so we want to use tonight the representation here. First of all, the Father sent Jesus to the earth. And Jesus had the responsibility to live his life without sin and then die on the cross as a sinless lamb to allow these things to be manifest. And so his blood was precious, his life was precious, and it paid for and atoned for every sin and unrighteousness that we could ever commit. It also allows us, amen, to be healed. Amen. I'm glad I believe it tonight. Amen. It allows us to use his name when we get sick. It allows us to drive spirits from us. Amen. And allows us to walk in a different realm than we walked in before. Without being saved, you have no authority over a spirit. Without being saved and without having the authority that Jesus, amen, delegates to the church, then you cannot and you do not have the right to use the name of Jesus. If you are sinful and you're disobedient, you don't have the right to use it until you repent. We'll use the story of the seven sons of Sceva. They went and found a man that was demon-possessed, and they were not saved. They didn't have authority. And they said, "We adjure you by the Spirit whom Paul preaches to come out." And the spirits that were in this man said, "Jesus we know and Paul we know, but who are you?" And they jumped on this guy. They're actually seven sons. And jumped on all seven of them, beat them up, and drove them from the house. Because they don't have the right to use the name of Jesus. Amen. I cannot tell you how many people have come to church who are backslidden or disobedient to God and are not following the things of God and come down here and want Jesus to heal them or deliver them and set them free anyway, irregardless of how they live. But the real reality of being a Christian is all about character. It's all about behavior. And you cannot reap the benefit, hello, without being obedient. Hello, you can't do it. Jesus would be a con artist if he just let anybody and everybody receive of the blessing and they never had to be saved. Often I have people talking to me that are trying to talk me into whatever they're doing is okay. And I finally, and one man I talked to for a lengthy time, and I finally had to say to him that, you know, you're trying to get me to say that it's okay for you to do what you're doing. And I said, it really doesn't make a difference of my opinion what I think. It doesn't make a difference because the Bible says that's a sin. And when the Bible says it's a sin, it's a sin. I'm nobody. Who am I to tell God that he can't call that a sin? And so when it is a sin, then you have to repent from it and let his name, let his word. 1 John says, if you confess his sin, he's faithful and just to forgive you of your sin and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Amen. Let me share a few more things. Amen. These are really important points. The Bible says the more excellent name came by, let me read it again. Some men are born to a great name, a king, for instance. Others make their name great by their achievements. Still others have a great name conferred upon them. The more excellent name came by all three means. Jesus' name is great because he inherited a great name. His name is great because of his achievements. His name is great because it was conferred upon him. Let me read that again. The more excellent name came by all three means. Jesus' name is great because he inherited a great name. His name is great because of his achievements. His name is great because it was conferred upon him. And so God the Father, amen, placed the name of Jesus upon his son. And the Bible says in Hebrews that he only had one. In the book of John, it says the same thing many other places, that God only had one son. And his name is and was Jesus. Hello? And so that name was conferred upon him. And in the Bible, it said that since Jesus defeated all principalities and powers, that his name is above every other name. Hello? His name is above every sickness, every disease, every sin, anything that's in the earth, you can name it. Jesus' name is above it. His name was conferred upon him. Amen. If you go down to the bank and you stand in the lobby and some famous man or woman comes into the bank and you know that they have extremely large amounts of money and they go up to the teller and they ask the teller, I'd like to withdraw $4 million. And the teller will look for the ID and want the bank account number, and they will check it out. And if they find that the person is who they say they are, the teller will go and get the $4 million and put it in a briefcase. Can I get a witness? Amen. And they'll give it to the person because their name, amen, it's conferred upon them. It belongs to them. The money belongs to them. Their name is in the bank. It's in the archives. It's everywhere. And they can prove who they are. Then they can back it up. And the bank will then, in turn, give them the things that they desire of. Amen. I don't go to the bank all that often, but I have been to the bank and I have seen people go up to the teller and they needed a certain amount of money. And so they put all their identification on the counter, and I have watched the teller go back into the bank, amen, where all the money is. I like to go back there sometime. Can I get a witness? Amen. And I have seen them come out with large amounts of money and give it to the person. Now, I can't go up there and do that because I don't have that kind of money in the bank. Hello. But that person had the right and the proof, and their name says that they have the right to take that money and they can use it for whatever they want. Amen. In the earth, we are God's representatives. The Bible calls us His ambassadors. So many people want to go around and throw their chest out and tell people how great they are. They're the great evangelists from East Texas. Can I get a witness? Amen. Or there's some prophet, amen, from New Orleans. Can I get a witness? Amen. They're some great person somewhere. And the thing that makes a Christian great is not the person. It's the person of Jesus. The name of Jesus made the difference in your life. When you called upon the name of the Lord because of His sacrifice, you got saved. And after that, you got filled with the Spirit. And after that, the gifts began to operate. And it's not because you're great, because you're not great. You're just a human being. Hello? Come on up here. If you're great, amen, and you're invincible, come up here and let me pinch you real good. Let me see what you got. Amen. Hello? Someone said, don't you dare. I get tired of hearing people on the TV, and many times I've gone to seminars, minister seminars, and I've had people come up to me and say, oh, great man of God, how are you today? And not only that, not only is it not true, but it's just a bunch of baloney. And you know they're blowing smoke at you, amen. And they're saying things about you, amen. I need help. Can I get a witness to get out of bed and get into my car? Can I get a witness, amen? Get showered and shaved, amen. I don't know why it is. It takes me longer today to do it than it did when I was 20. Hello? And I'm doing the same stuff. Hello? I'm preaching to me tonight. God allows us to join His family, and then He allows us to use His name and to use these things for His kingdom, not for our own personal gain, not so that we could say that we're great, amen. It doesn't work that way, and then He doesn't get the credit, and He's the one that should get the credit. There's nobody on the planet that lived a life on the earth without sinning. There's nobody in here in China, Russia, anywhere else. I don't care who you are. The Bible says all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. The only one that ever walked the earth and didn't sin was Jesus. He is the only one. If your name isn't Jesus and you're not raised from the dead, I'm not talking about you. Hello. Nobody else could do it. The Bible says in Revelation, when the books are about to be opened and the seals to be broken, that John said they were looking for somebody that could open the seals, and no one could do it. And the angel said, don't worry, we got a brother here. His name is Jesus, and he's going to open the seals. And he began to open the seals and the various plagues and things began to operate. Why did that happen? Because of the name of Jesus. His excellent name is above everything that's in heaven or in earth. His name is above it. Amen. I find that I want to advance in the kingdom of God. And I know people that when they're supposed to be building their church, they're not doing that. They're building their own kingdom. I've had people tell me, that they don't pray, they have a group of people that prays for them. And I have seen people, amen, they're depending on someone else to study for them. Hello? Well, what if somebody that I know, I send them to college and they get an education, they know everything, and then I try to take the credit for what they know? I can't do it because I don't know it. They could tell me the moon's made out of green cheese and I'm not going to know any different. Hello? Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, the Bible says we ignorance, amen, the lack of knowledge is what's killing Christians. And I'm telling you tonight, there's more and more Christians that are falling away because of a lack of knowledge, of trying to apply things that do not work. And I've seen people, they're supposed to pray and they don't pray. And I said earlier in the message, and I'll say it again, that prayer, amen, is not only means unmerited favor, but it also means empowerment. And if you don't pray, you will not be empowered to live the Christian life. You cannot live a Christian life without prayer. You cannot live a Christian life without Jesus coming into your heart. You can't live the life, because if you could, you would not need Jesus, amen, to come in there. And then if your life changed after you got saved and now you're able to live the Christian life, who should get the credit but Jesus, the Son of God, who gave you power to live the Christian life? You can't do it on your own. If you could do it on your own, you would be equal with Jesus. And I'm sorry to say that you're not equal with Jesus. Amen. Come on, some of us can't even walk across the street without sinning. Hello. I'm preaching to me. I love this topic because it puts us in a place where we're supposed to be. It puts us in a place of submission. It puts us in a place that we are dependent upon God. We're dependent upon His power. We're dependent upon all His suffering that He paid for us. We're depending upon God to do things for us. I don't know how you are tonight, but I'm depending not only now, I will tomorrow. I'll be depending on God to help me get through not only today, but tomorrow. I will pray and I will ask for His help, but I know right now before I ever get to tomorrow, I'm going to need His help. I can't do it on my own. If I'm going to get my bills paid, if I'm going to live the Christian life or whatever, I'm going to need to pray. I'm going to need to yield to the name of Jesus and to His instructions, or I'm going to get into trouble. I have run into people who have friends that are bad news. Hello? I know some pastors, I know how they build their church, and it's not on this foundation of the Word of God. And I know people that hang out with these pastors, so-called, and always the consequence is disastrous. Because the person they're hanging out with don't pray, they don't let the gifts operate, they don't do the things they're supposed to do. And many people are trying to just to be like somebody who has a lot of people and a lot of money, and they're not trying to be like Jesus. They're not trying to be like the kingdom. Hello? I want to be like the kingdom. I want to walk like Jesus walked. He lived by faith. He did not have a huge bank account, but he had great faith. Can I get a witness? He walked the earth believing and trusting in His Father, and He constantly made the statement, I'm not here to do my own will, but to do the will of the Father. I'm here to help people. I'm here to bring deliverance to people, but this is what God the Father has asked me to do. Many times I've talked to preachers, and in their attitude, they want to preach in a certain place. They want to get a certain amount of money for every time they preach. They want to drive a certain kind of car. They want to live in a certain kind of house. But that's not what they're supposed to be doing. They're supposed to be building the kingdom. I know one person that's supposed to be an evangelist, and they were opposed by their family, and so they never became an evangelist. And so that meant they never went where they're supposed to be. They never preached the evangelistic message to the people they were supposed to. And down life's road, God was merciful for a long time. But once judgment fell, that was it, and the man passed away. I'm not here to tell God what to do. I was talking to my bookkeeper this week. I took our stuff to them for the last month. And she was telling me about how that I find the exact same things happen to other people. But she said there are people, amen, that are trying to find a way to retire. There are people that save their money up. There are people that wanted to do certain things when they retired. But they found that sickness got to them. They found that other difficulties arose, and they never did get to do what they wanted to do. And in the book of James, I told her, I understand that. I'm trying to finish up my race with Jesus. But I'm not going to tell God what I should do to finish it up. I'm not going to tell him that I want to do thus said the Lord, or I'm not going to finish. I don't want to do that. I'm not going to tell God anything. His IQ makes me look like a peanut brain. Can I get a witness? Amen. Hello. I might make a decision. I've seen people, they want to move to a certain place, and the next, whenever season is, there's 15 tornadoes and hurricanes in their neighborhood. It might look good now, but amen, come tornado season, amen, ain't nothing going to be left of the house, nothing left of the countryside, amen. Amen. I'm not going to do it. I've seen people go and do things without prayer, and they are disastrous effects to people that don't listen to God. The Apostle Paul had spiritual discernment, and they were getting ready to get on the ship, amen, in the book of Acts. And he had spiritual discernment. It was a nice day. The wind started blowing nice, sunshine, and everybody's going to get on the ship and take off. And Paul said, I perceive that this voyage is going to be with much danger and also possibly the loss of life and cargo of this ship. And the people said, nah, it ain't. And they got in the ship and they took off. And they went, and as they were sailing, they went into a storm. They called it a Euroclydon. It's probably equivalent to a hurricane. Now, I don't know how... I know today there's great big ships and they might be able to transverse a hurricane. But I'll guarantee you the ship that they were in no condition to try to go through a hurricane. And so it did come to pass that the ship crashed on an island, but everybody came safe to land because the Apostle Paul prayed for everybody, and because God's blessing was upon him, then everyone made it safe to land. God's word came to pass because of one man's obedience. Amen. So I find it difficult. I want to take a few more minutes, but I'm burdened for some people. Nobody here. I'm burdened for people that listen to the wrong voice. I'm burdened for people who somebody that tells them something, and because they are uneducated, they do not know what the Bible says, and so they go out and do something, and then they suffer for it. And I feel bad for people. Amen. I don't know if you've ever... You ought to go with me sometime. I have seen people. Amen. Sometimes I've been to the hospital. And I have seen people so sad. It's just beyond the ability to comprehend. Their loved one is so sick, and they're probably not going to survive. And as I sit with them, sometimes there's no words I can even say. There's nothing I can really do but just sit with them and realize that they are really suffering for the difficulty of their loved one. I have seen people, amen, do things in traffic they shouldn't do and they get hit or somebody else hits them or whatever. My wife was very fortunate, amen. She was sitting at a signal and someone plowed in the back of our car and just wiped out the car. Was totally, amen, totaled. And we had to go through all kinds of gyrations, but the insurance came through to help us, but we thank the Lord for that. But what I'm saying tonight is that you don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. And when you leave out of here, or you're going to get up tomorrow and go somewhere, and you don't pray, you are taking your life in your hands. If you don't pray before you get going, you are really in trouble. Because you do not know what's out there. And my battle, again, isn't with people. It's with spirits. And how many know the devil doesn't like you? I'm going to share a story. I've shared it many times. I haven't shared it in a while. I was driving down the street one day. And the Spirit of the Lord came upon me, and I began to pray, and I began to pray in tongues. And I prayed for a season, and I felt there was a peace, and so I stopped. And I wondered, what in the world was that about? And the next day, I'm driving down the street, and this person turns right in front of me and stops, blocking my lane. And so I lock it up, and I think, I'm going to hit this car, amen. I might die or whatever, but there's bad news coming because they're blocking the whole lane. And I slammed on the brakes, and when I stopped, there couldn't have been an inch between our automobiles. And the person apologized or whatever, but my heart was like, I mean, it was pounding, and I went down the street, and the Lord spoke to me. And he said, do you know why you didn't hit that car? I said, no, I'm just glad I didn't hit it. He said, because you prayed yourself through yesterday. When you prayed yourself through that you would not hit that car and be in an accident. I don't know about you, but often the devil has taken shots at me. Anybody here tonight that the devil has taken shots at you or physical, whatever, mental, in your automobile or somewhere. It is true. And the devil, amen, is trying to stop what you're trying to do. And so God is giving us avenues that we can conquer the enemy. Let me read a little bit more here. This is out of Hebrews. God, who at sundry times and in divers manners spake in times past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he hath appointed heir, you ought to underline that, of all things, by whom also he made the worlds, who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high, being made by so much better than the angels, as he hath by inheritance obtained a more excellent name than they. For unto which of the angels said he at any time, that thou art my son, this day have I begotten thee? And again, I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son. And again, when he bringeth in the first begotten in the world, he saith, let all the angels of God worship him. And it says here, he hath by inheritance obtained a more excellent name. He has obtained a more excellent name than all the angels, all the principalities and powers, everyone else on the planet. It's the name of Jesus. Again, hello? When you realize that he is the only one that could do what he did. He's the only one that could walk the earth without sin. He's the only one that was willing to do what his Father asked him to do. Hello? He's the only one in all the universe anywhere that can reap the benefit of accomplishing something that no one else could accomplish. Hello? I know people that are trying to make themselves equal with God, but I want you to know you can't do what he did. You can reap the benefit from what he did by accepting him, but it's really his spirit that makes you better. Can I get a witness? Amen. Is there anybody in here you used to do all kinds of crazy stuff and when you got saved, you quit doing them? Hello. Hello. Yeah, I did crazy stuff. I didn't probably do what everybody else did, but sin is sin. None of us did the right thing, amen? And so when I got saved, my life changed. And I couldn't do it myself because I tried. Anybody like me tried to stop doing what you were doing, sinning, amen? Were you successful? No, you just kept sinning. Hello. I did. I tried. You just don't know. There's things I did I was ashamed of, and I tried to stop doing them. And guess what? The next week, I did it again. Hello. I tried to stop doing a certain thing or whatever it was, and I do it again. Over and over and over, I thought, you're going to do it again. I don't care what you promise or what you say. And I didn't understand I needed the power of God to stop doing what I was doing. And when I got saved, I changed. I was talking to some people. And I'll never forget the first Christmas I had. After I got saved, we began to sing Christmas carols. And I thought all the years that I was coming up, I was 21 years old when I got saved, that I knew what those songs meant. And I started singing Christmas carols for the first time in my life, and I knew what every song really meant for the first time. Listen to me. I had a fit that Christmas because I said joy to the world and I knew what I was talking about. Amen. Before I sang it without the anointing, without the understanding, without being a Christian. And then after you get saved, amen, you realize you really know what you're doing. You are saved. You understand that the Son of God came into the world. I talked to a man one time and he said, I don't understand what you're talking about. And I realized that he never was saved because if you get saved, you will change. I'm preaching to me. You will know more things. You'll begin to understand the Bible and those words will mean something to you. Hello. I always use the carol, God rest ye merry gentlemen, let nothing you dismay. Remember, Christ our Savior was born upon this day to save us all from Satan's power when we were gone astray. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy. Man, I sang that song as loud as I could because I knew that Jesus did that for me. Come on, amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Best way I can express this, it's by inheritance, by his ability that he does things. And you have to follow them and you have to invest in good things if you want good things to happen to you. And this week when I went to my doctor, I hate going to the doctor. I don't know what I'm talking about, but I hate going. My doctor asked me. One time, do you like coming here? I said, no. I said, you don't look for anything that's right. You're always looking for something that's wrong, and I don't like it. Amen. Why don't you tell me, amen, my hair is at least combed, and you like my shoes or whatever. Hello. You're not looking for what's right. You're looking for what's wrong, and I don't want to know what's wrong. Tell me what's right. I'm the only one that feels that way. Don't look for something's wrong. Just overlook it. so he looked at my chart and saw my blood pressure. And he knew that I changed. So all I had to do was look at one thing. He knew I was changed. I'd been doing something different, and I had different results. Just been a few months, and all of those things that were bothering me with my blood pressure have gone away. Hello. And the same thing happened to me when I got saved. I quit hanging with the same people I was hanging with. In fact, every one of my friends left. Hello. They thought I was crazy. I said, if this is crazy, I wish I'd have got this crazy sooner. Amen. And I began to have friends in the church and began to meet friends that were Christians. And I, for whatever reason, all of my old friends wouldn't even talk to me. Well, why is that? We're not of the same spirit. It's not about the person. It's about the spirit. Hello. We're gonna go into election. We're gonna go into some things. Somebody was talking to me this week about some stuff. And I don't care who they elect. The problem is not with that person. It's wrong. It's with the spiritual realm and the time that we live. And I can't prove it, but I really believe that the Antichrist and the false prophet are alive and well right now walking on the earth. Somewhere they're here, and there's people already right now trying to work as hard as they can for a one-world church, a one-world government, and a one-world currency. And many of those are Christian pastors. Hello. And I'm telling you, you don't want to mess with God. God told you not to do those kind of things, and people are doing them purposely, and one of these days they're going to pay the price for doing and saying things they're not supposed to do. One of these days, amen, it's going to be like the Dathan and Abiram and Korah, amen. They were famous people in Israel. One of these days, amen, something bad is going to happen to a whole bunch of famous preachers that have disobeyed God. The ground's going to open up and they're going to disappear, and people are going to have a heart attack because their favorite preacher, amen, died and went to hell. Hello. I know someone said you shouldn't have said that, but it's what happened in Israel. And not only one, many famous people died and were lost forever. Hello, many of them. Hello. I don't want to mess with God. Can you open the ground up and swallow up 23,000 people? You want to mess with somebody that can do that, amen? That can make a 100-pound hailstone and throw it at you? I'm messing with nobody can do that. Hello? Hello? Out of the first two plagues on the earth, half the people of the earth are going to die. In just two plagues. I don't want to mess with them. Hello? I don't want to mess with them. There's things I realize that God wants me to do, and I want to finish up. And I want to do what God has called me to do. And I realize that by using His name, I can accomplish what God put me on the earth for. I'm not against people. I don't care what their situations are. I'm for God. And I like to see God begin to build His temple the way He wants it in people. I like to see people change. I like to see people do the things that God called them to do. Not everybody can preach, and not everybody's going to sing, and not everyone's going to evangelize, not everyone's going to do that. But things that you used to do that you know are wrong, you begin to change, and you don't do them anymore. And pretty soon somebody's going to come up to you, and they'll look you in the eyes and say, you've changed. You used to go down to the bar, but you don't go there anymore. Hello? You used to go to this place, but you don't go there anymore. I used to listen to your language. Your language has really been cleaned up. Can I get a witness? Amen. I heard a man testifying one time, and he said his language was so bad he could peel the paint off the wall with it. Hello? Hello? He said it. I didn't. He said that's what his language was like. And so I realized that God, amen, has given me an avenue. And he's the only one, both by inheritance, by what he accomplished, by God conferring his name upon him, that can allow me to do things I could never do before. Allow me to get through my life and help other people and get through my dilemmas the way that God intended for me to get through them. It doesn't do me any good to try to boast in myself because I can't do anything without God. It doesn't do me any good, amen, to say things like Pastor Dan was saying about the man that had a little thing on his shirt and he kept leaning forward so people could read it. And so Dan wondered what this guy was doing, so he came over to talk to him and he leaned over and the man had a card. It was at a conference and it said, Apostle, Prophet, Evangelist, Pastor, and Teacher. And Pastor Dan greeted him and said, Jesus, I didn't know that you looked like you did. Amen. You can't be it all. You can't do it all. Amen. I didn't know Jesus was Italian. Can I get a witness? Amen. Amen. There's a new wind blowing in the earth. And some people are catching drift of what God really wants for them. And they're beginning to listen to what thus saith the Lord. And God is changing people, not everyone. But some people, like myself and others, are watching other people. And I realize that people are failing because they're not trying to be like Jesus. They're trying to get money. They're trying to have lots of people. They're trying to do things they want to do. But none of it has to do with what God put them on the earth for. And so I realized, you know, I don't want to end up, amen, on the other side of the fence or eternally separated from God. So my prayer is, what do you want me to do? As I talked to my bookkeeper this week, we were talking about retirement. Her husband is getting or wanting to retire. And I said to her, I know so many people that they decided they wanted to retire on a certain day and whatever, but they didn't take God into consideration. And I know a whole truckload of people that died on the last day of work, that they died, amen, and had a heart attack or whatever. And they never got to do one thing that they planned to do. In the book of James, it said people wanted to go to such and city and buy and sell and get gain. And James said, you should say, if the Lord wills, that you'll go there. Sennacherib sent his soldiers in, or was getting ready to send his soldiers in to battle against Israel. And they said, we're coming down there and don't trust in your prophets because you're dead tonight. And what happened is he heard a word. Somebody's trying to take over his kingdom. He left, went back in his own country, and his own children, his own sons, killed him. I've had people say things to me like, you're going to starve to death if you take that church. You ain't never going to make it. You're going to have more problems than you know what to do with. And even though we don't have a lot, I want to say God, to God be the glory. He has paid every bill. He has touched people. He's brought people out of the hospital that shouldn't, amen, come out of there. He has done great things for me and for this church, and he's been doing it for years. Praise the Lord and bless his wonderful name. When you hear the name of Jesus, you should stop. When you hear the name of Jesus, you should just reverence that name. When you hear his name mentioned, wherever you are, you should just stop. When we're in church and there's prophecy or tongues and Spirit of God is moving, you should stop. And you should listen to what God is saying. I'm going to close with this and we're going to pray. I can't cover all these things tonight. It's too many. They said at this Seattle World's Fair many years ago, they took, I believe it's Da Vinci's Pietà. If you don't know what that is Mary sitting on the ground with Jesus lying in her lap, and Mary's holding Jesus. And they said as people were walking by this exhibit, every person stopped when they got to the exhibit to observe Mary holding Jesus. Everybody, I don't care what religion, who they were, everybody stopped and looked. And I don't know, somehow people have to know that there's nothing like it in all the world for Jesus to have done what he did for humanity. And Mary, of course, knew her son. And for people to recognize that that was the most significant thing that's ever happened on the planet. That's why the Spirit of God can make you different. But you got to focus upon the Lord. You got to focus upon His purpose for you. If you don't focus on that, you're going to go out and do something you're not supposed to do, and there may not be any blessing on it. Oh, I know people right now that are hurting tonight because they made bad decisions. Hello. I know people that, amen, made decision to do something and none of it worked. None of it worked because there was no prayer beforehand. I always say it, though. I've seen people, and I know several, that wanted a certain kind of car. And so they went and bought a car, whatever kind of car they wanted. They bought this car, and they hated the car. The car broke down every 15 minutes. They put more money into that jalopy than they could ever afford, really. And after a while, they realized they don't want that kind of car. Hello. I've heard other people tell me they wanted a certain specific car and they got that car and it cost them a small fortune to tune it up or to change the oil. I know somebody, it's $1,000 to change the oil on their car. Hello. I don't know about you, but if I have $1,000, I'm not going to pay for my oil to be changed. Y'all, listen, my car is going to run forever on that oil that's in there because I ain't never going to change it. Not for $1,000. Y'all not listen to me. I ain't changing it. Amen. It can run or not run, but I'm not paying. I'm not going to pay $1,000 for an oil change. I'll go get me a bicycle first. It won't even cost me a couple hundred to get a bicycle. Y'all can keep the car. We're going to take a minute to pray. And I want to tell you, you have the right to use the name of Jesus. But it was meant for you to develop your character. It was meant for you to help other people. It was meant for you to realize that His name is above every other name. And it was meant for you to give Him glory every time He answers one of your prayers. It was meant for His name to be above every situation that's in your life. I would not be here tonight if it wasn't for the name of Jesus. It's the only way I could be here tonight. Thank God he came to the earth. Thank God he shed his blood. Thank God he's been with me for over 40 years to help me, to bring me to the place I am today. Thank God for his great mercy. Would you bow your heads with me tonight? We're going to pray. Father, we thank you tonight in the mighty name of Jesus for being here. We thank you for each one you've sent. And Lord, tonight we're asking you that we could allow your name to penetrate our hearts tonight, that we would use your name in the proper way, in the correct way, that we can be a blessing to others, and that you could build your kingdom in this place, this house, among this people, and that we would put you first, and every time you do something good for us, we give you the glory. Thank you for touching people. Thank you for ministering to their needs. We know there's many people that you have blessed in this church, in this house. And so, God, you see the future. You see what is out there for us. Lord, we apply your name right now to those things that are yet ahead of us. Let your name, the name of Jesus, be applied to every difficulty, every sickness, every problem, every legal issue. May your name be applied to every situation. Touch your people tonight, Lord, and we will give you all the glory and the praise and honor. And we ask these things tonight in your name, the name of Jesus. And everyone said, amen. Anyone tonight like prayer? Would you come now and we'll take time to pray for you? Anybody at all? We'll be glad to do that. Praise the Lord. Amen. Would you stand with me, please? We're going to dismiss in a word of prayer. One more time, would you turn to your neighbor and tell them, I love you and you can't do nothing about it. Tell them, I love you and you can't do nothing about it. Amen. God bless you. Greet someone and tell them you're glad they came. God bless you.